Lately I've been looking back, a long life's winding road, to the old familiar markers of the mercies I have known. And I know it may sound simple, but it's more than a cliche. There's no other words to tell you but to say, God's been good in my life. I feel blessed beyond my wildest dreams when I go to sleep each night. Though I've had my share of hard times, I wouldn't change them if I could. So through it all, God's been good. Times replay and I can see I've cried some bitter tears, but I felt His arms around me as I faced my darkest fears. I've had more gains than losses, and I've known more joy than hurt, as His grace rolled down upon me on this earth. God's been good in my life. I feel blessed beyond my wildest dreams when I go to sleep each night. No, I've had my share of hard times, I wouldn't change them if I could. 'Cause through it all, God's been good. God has been my Father, He's been my Savior and my friend. His love was my beginning, His love will be my end. I can share with some blessings to tell you everything He is. So the best way I can say it is like this: God's been good in my life. I feel blessed beyond my wildest dreams when I go to sleep each night. Though I've had my share of hard times, I wouldn't change them if I could. 'Cause through it all, God's been good.
Psalm 9, verse 17. Let's pray just for a second. Father, thank you. God, thank you for this precious word of God. It guides us, tells us right from wrong. It's our final authority in faith and practice, and there's not a mistake in it. And Father, we thank you for it. And God, as we look to it tonight, and kind of plow through some stuff, we pray there'd be a point to it, and it would mean something to us as we leave tonight. We'd be able to say it's been good to be in the house of God. Forgive me for my sins, I pray. Bless now as we look to thy precious word and you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 9:17, the wicked shall be turned into hell, and all the nations that forget God. I want to talk about all the nations tonight. So all the nations that forget God will be turned into hell. You say, how can that be? It's quite obvious now that there are nations around the world that have just forgotten about God. And contrary to what the Pope says, God has a name, Jehovah, capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, means the same as Jehovah. It's a tetragrammaton. We've talked about it before. The four Hebrew characters that refer to the name of God. I am that I am. Same thing. So you can't just go whatever way you want to. Every man did that which was right in his own eyes. Doesn't work. So there's Psalm 9:7. Now we're going to jump over to the New Testament, Matthew 25. Matthew chapter 25, verse 32. Well, we'll read verse 31 as well while we're here. Matthew 25, verse 31. When the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory. And before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them one from another, as a shepherd divideth his sheep from the goats. And he shall set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on the left. Then shall the king say unto them on his right hand, come, ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom provided, prepared for you from the foundation of the world. And on it goes. Now remember, these are nations. These are not people, they're nations. He says so. Before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them one from another. And then Revelation. We'll stay in Revelation for a few minutes. Revelation chapter 9, verse 16. Let's back up and read verse 13. Now, 8 through 10 is the what we call the trumpet judgments. You got the seals, the vials, seals, the trumpets, and the vials. Now, my opinion, belief, is that they're all the same. Just like the four Gospels talk about one life, the life of Jesus Christ, four perspectives. And I believe the seals, trumpets, and vials all show you that seven-year period of tribulation on earth after the rapture. So, verse 13, and the six angels sounded, and I heard a voice from the four horns of the golden altar, which is before God, saying to the sixth angel, which had the trumpet, loose the four angels which are bound in the great river Euphrates. And the four angels were loosed, which were prepared for an hour and a day and a month and a year, for to slay the third part of men. And the number of the army of the horsemen were 200,000,000. Now, 1,000,000 is a million. 200,000,000 is 200,000,000. Now that is a big, I heard the number of them. Now, if you had an army of 200,000,000,000 advancing on you, I can imagine you would feel it in the earth, and you would hear the sound of battle, and you would hear the horses and all of that stuff, or whatever was coming. If it were tanks, you'd certainly hear that. It would be a frightening sound, I would say. I've told you about those guys jumping over the boards in the hockey game at the midget championships in Lewiston. And midget championships, I think, were 17-year-olds, something like that. But when I saw those guys coming over the boards, the whole team, and we were sitting right behind the bench, and here they came across the ice, and you could just see them coming. It was a fearful thing. And you know bad stuff was about to happen, and it did. I mean, they had the cops in there and the whole deal. It was a bad situation. Can you imagine 200,000,000,000 people, an army, coming? I mean, it's just unbelievable. Revelation 19:11. Revelation 19:11. And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. Now, there is, under the seals, you got a white horse coming, but it's not Jesus Christ. He's a conqueror, but it's not Jesus Christ. This, when heaven is opened. So, you know, Satan's not coming out of heaven. Lucifer and a bad army, isn't it? They'll come out of the pits of hell, but they're not coming out of heaven. I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon it was called Faithful, capital F, and True. Well, there's only one that's really faithful and true, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. And in righteousness, he doth judge and make war. Let's keep reading. We're having a good time doing that. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. Well, if you had any doubt about it, that would solve it. This is the Lord Jesus Christ coming. And the Bible says, in righteousness he doth judge and make war. Revelation 19:14. And the armies which are in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. All righty. Verse 15. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations. And he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and he treadeth the winepress, and, the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. Revelation chapter 20, verse 8. We'll read verse 7. And when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison. We've now jumped ahead to the end of the millennium. So the 1,000-year reign of Christ is following the tribulation. That'll begin at Armageddon when he comes back, and there'll be a war there. We just read something about it. But now you jump ahead to 1,000 years. We're not told a lot about this situation, but we see a little bit about it right here. When the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison. Well, the beast and the false prophet have been in the lake of fire for 1,000 years now, but Satan has been locked up in the abyss, if you will, for 1,000 years, and he's loosed out of his prison. And shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four quarters of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, the number of whom is as the sand of the sea. Might as well keep reading again a little bit. And they went up on the breadth of the earth and compassed the camp of the saints about, and the beloved city, Jerusalem, and fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. And the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. Now I'll just quote to you a couple. In Psalm 33:12, the Bible says this: Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, and the people whom he hath chosen for his inheritance, his own inheritance. And then in Proverbs 14:34, righteousness exalteth a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. Now, I don't think this is going to take long, what I'm about to say. Number one, the nations are often mentioned in the Bible. And I've given you a few of those, but by no means an exhaustive list. The nations are often mentioned in the Bible. Nations, as we've just read, and we've just read all of these things, nations forget God. Nations will be gathered to battle, Revelation 28:9. The sixth angel hosted a 200 million army. Well, Satan's hosting it, I guess you'd say, but they're gathered together at that trumpet sound. Jesus comes back to judge and to make war. He comes back as a head of armies. He comes back to smite the nations, Revelation 19:15. He comes back with fierceness and wrath. It is the wrath of Almighty God. And according to Isaiah 34:8, it is the day of the Lord's vengeance. And the blood will run deep for approximately 160 miles up to the horses' bridles, Revelation 14:20. Now, this is the fate of the nations. This is where they're headed. We could say the United Nations. Now, I don't know about all of them, and you know, the battle hasn't arrived yet. I don't know what's going to transpire. But nations getting together doesn't really impact God very much, folks. I don't care about public opinion. I don't care about the consensus of opinion. I don't care how many nations get together and vote on this or that. God is coming back, and he is going to smite the nations. That's one. Number two, nothing done by the nations in the last 50 years has been of much value. nor have they solved basic problems. I mean, I think we'd all agree we got problems today, amen? In the world. The world has gone haywire. And what the world, the conventional wisdom, or the definition of right and wrong, according to the world, does not match up with the Bible. They can't figure out which restroom to send people to. And if anybody can figure it out, oh, there's something wrong with them. Shame on you. You're a bad person. Okay? Common sense has gone. Common sense is gone. And the people, you know, Mike's always quoting, woe unto him, the woe unto them that call evil good and good evil. I don't know when we arrived at that point, but it was a long time ago. And it's becoming more and more blatant in the world. And only the second coming. Those nations are never going to do either of those two things that I mentioned. Nothing of value, no solution of basic problems, and they're not going to. It's not going to happen. The answer is in this book. The answer is with God. He has the answers. The nations are not going to have the answers. They haven't. The world is a mess because of the nations. And they're not going to solve it. They don't have the ability to solve it. Enoch in Sunday school today, another great Sunday school lesson. And I've got a couple things that, again, this was done during the week. We don't talk about his Sunday school lesson in my sermon, but a couple of the things. I've got a couple of the same verses in here. We'll get to them in a moment. But look, it's a mess. Only the second coming of Christ will solve these problems. Only the second coming of Christ will solve these problems. Now, we can try. Hopefully, we could get somebody with some, even if it's by accident, some semblance of righteousness to lead our nation. But only the second coming of Christ will really solve the problems. And this will be done, folks, by war. It'll be done by war. And the war will be won by power. The Lord is a man of war. We didn't read that reference, but Exodus 15:3, the Lord is a man of war. And the concept is destruction, death, and annihilation. Now, not the annihilation that the Jehovah's Witnesses talk about, but when you get thrown into the lake of fire, I would consider it to be annihilation, even though you're still alive. So probably wrong definition, probably the wrong word. But it's destruction, it's elimination. And then call it whatever you want to, because the smoke of the atonement riseth forever and ever. And what we just read over here in chapter 20, they'll be tormented night and day forever and ever. Peter Ruckman said it was a reverse evolution, going back devolution. And talks about, you know, I'm a worm, and going back to where the worm dieth not. So, you know, you can make what you want out of that, but I'll tell you what, there's something spiritual and physical about the lake of fire. The lake of fire is a real place. Now, it's a physical place, but it's also a spiritual place. You say, how do these bodies burn forever and not be consumed? Well, your soul is a different kind of thing. I almost said a different animal. And however that's going to work out, God knows. And maybe I'm not smart enough to answer those questions, but I'll tell you, it's not going to be pretty. So when God comes back, when the only solution left to him, and, you know, we can look at this and answer some of those questions that I've said, that I've wrestled with, of why he went into the promised land, just wiped everybody out. Well, at some point, that's his mode of operation. I mean, what else can we gather from that? At some point, God looks at it and says, okay, here's the only solution. The lake of fire is an example of that. So it comes a point where individuals or the nations will be wiped out. I mean, can you imagine for 160 miles of blood running up to the horses' bridles? I mean, imagine that. That's some serious warfare, folks. And God says it. And we all believe our Bibles, amen? So they say, well, you want to explain all this to me? I don't know that I can. I just know God says it and it's going to happen. I can remember, 1967, 68, reading Jean Dixon's The Gift of Prophecy. And she said in 1999 there was going to be World War III and men would die like ants. Well, maybe Satan told her a little bit, but he didn't tell her everything. Because it's going to be a big war and it's going to be bad. Amen? But it didn't happen when she said it was going to happen. It's a false prophetess. And it's not going to be like she said it was. It's not got to do with really armies of the world other than them gathering together and going against God. And it's not going to work good. And my fourth point is this. Internationalism, globalism, is ungodliness. Now, I'm not budging off that point. Amen? This is not a campaign statement. I've said it for years and years and years and years and years. Internationalism slash globalism is ungodliness. We cannot, as a country, the United States of America, once upon a time, it was based on the foundation of God. Now we've gone away from that. I mean, we've thrown God out of every public place we can imagine. We don't go by the Bible. We don't get our common sense from the Bible. We don't get our judicial decisions out of the Bible. We get them out of our own head. We've gotten to the point almost where every imagination of man's heart was only evil continually. We're getting close to that point, folks. So I have blasted globalism forever because we ought to be a nation under God. And we shouldn't be submitting at all to the vote of ungodly countries. So what I'm saying is when you hear globalism or internationalism, I say that's ungodliness. Now, 1 John 5:19 says this, "We know that we are of God, and the whole world lieth in wickedness." You believe that? We know that we are of God, and the whole world lieth in wickedness. 1 John 5:19. You are familiar with 2 Corinthians 4:3 and 4, of course. "But if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them." You've got the whole world lying in wickedness, and we know the God of this world is Lucifer, if we have a King James Version of the Bible. Because if you don't, you can't even find Lucifer in it, because they've taken his name out. Want to make sure people don't know who Lucifer is. Because, the Masons and others probably talking about he's Jesus' brother. Something like that. Anybody know about that? Mormon. Lucifer. Masons, 33rd degree. Lucifer's a pretty good guy, according to some. I've never been a Mason, never been a 33rd degree Mason. But they say when you get up high enough, you find out they're worshiping Lucifer. I don't know that for a fact. People that have been in there have said it and written books about it. We live in a world of abuse of people. ISIS has done terrible things. Hitler did terrible things. And plenty of others have as well. We live in a world of abusive people. We live in a world blinded by Satan. We live in a world that is against God. Listen, if you love the world, you're no friend of God. Amen? Friendship with the world is enmity with God, the Bible tells us. Well, what do you make of that? I got to figure the world is bad. Where do you think we get the term of worldliness? Being like the world. We live in a world that's against God. We live in a world of false gods. We went down to the restaurant today. So I came down a different way because of traffic and everything. I look on the right, and there's this ISHTAR, Ishtar, Mediterranean Restaurant and Grill. I said, I think I'm familiar with that term. It's a false goddess from Mesopotamia. What kind of knucklehead would name that restaurant? Why do you have Satan's restaurant? Come on in, the stuff on the grill is really good. We live in a world of false gods. We live in an ungodly world. Now look where the world, and I'm not going to get detailed about this, but look where the world is on sexual sin. Way off. Way off base. Look where the world is on the nation of Israel. Now, I'm not saying Israel is right with God. Okay? But God established Israel. And how can you have people in the United Nations, which I don't... Well, Dr. Boyle used to say, don't give a flying flip about it, whatever that meant. How can you have nations in the United Nations, which is supposed to promote peace, when their doctrine is to push Israel into the sea? Their doctrine is to eliminate Israel. Shouldn't they be thrown out of the United Nations? Shouldn't they be made, if it was worth a plug nickel, shouldn't they be made to renounce that doctrine before they ever step foot at the United Nations? And you wonder why I say we ought to get rid of the United Nations and get out of it. Because it's part of globalism. We could still cooperate with the world community, couldn't we? But I wouldn't be a part of anything where nations in there that have an equal vote or whatever, I don't know if they got equal vote or what kind of vote they got, but they do have a vote, where they would be in there saying we want to eliminate Israel. That's part of our doctrine. Can I say ridiculous? So look where the world is on sexual sin. Look where the world is on Israel. And look where the world is on violence. Now, turn to 2 Timothy chapter 3, if you would. I may not be telling you anything you didn't know, but just trying to remind you of some things you already did know. We're talking about all the nations. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 through 5. This know also. Brothers and sisters, we are supposed to know these things. We are supposed to know these things. You know, we're reading through our Bible. Okay, I knocked that verse off. Okay, I'm done with that chapter. Wait a minute, did you read what it said? This know also that in the last days... Now, I suppose that about 105% of us would say these are the last days. Okay? That's a hyperbole. 105% part of it. In the last days, perilous times shall come. They're here, aren't they? They're already here. It's crazy what the world is doing. Why? For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy. Unholy. That's sanctification. That's not following God. That's being separated from God. Holiness is being separated unto God. That's what it is. That's sanctification. Unholy. Well, we're there. Without natural affection. Well, you can broaden that about any way you want to. But that certainly is the case today. Truth breakers. False accusers. Incontinent. So that's without self-discipline. Fierce. Accusers. Incontinent. Did I read that twice? False accusers. Incontinent. Fierce. Despisers of those that are good. You stand up for righteousness now, people despise you. They'll shoot you down. You go on the college campus and say what I'm saying right now, and they'll shout you down. You'll have to go out the back door, and lucky if you get out the back door. Traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. Can we say church attendance? Lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. Just better hope your Sunday morning service doesn't line up with a ram schedule. Having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. Oh, there's all kinds of forms of godliness. That's all over the place. It's a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. From such turn away. For this sort are they which creep into houses and lead captive silly women laden with sins, led away with diverse lusts, ever learning, never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. All of that is taking place. Now, what can we discern from this message? Okay, I've talked about all the nations. really, hey, just throw it out there. Is there anything positive there? Well, in the first place, correctly applied, I believe knowledge is power. So the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge and wisdom. So correctly applied, knowledge is power. We have the power of God working within us, amen? And that's because we're saved, and that's because we have knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. So correctly applied, knowledge is power. And one of the verses that Enoch mentioned this morning in Sunday school had to do with what's over in Matthew chapter 16. And he criticized the Pharisees and said, in the morning it will be foul weather today. You can understand that. You look at, how many have heard that? I mean, red skies at night, sailors delight. Red skies at morning, sailors take warning. So Jesus said in the morning, he said, you guys say in the morning, it'll be foul weather today, for the sky is red and lowering. Oh, you hypocrites. You hypocrites. You can discern the face of the sky, but can you not discern the signs of the times? We need to have some power of discernment, folks. And it's got to be based on the Word of God. So number one, if you know what's going on, that's a good thing. You say, all right, the nations, boy, the nations, hey, the nations this, the nations that. Don't worry about it. You're supposed to be smarter than that. Why? Because God told you. He told you what He's going to do with the nations. Secondly, the more sinful the world, the more soon the world beater. The more sinful the world, the more sooner the world beater. Now, we've said that for 100 years now, and people have been writing about it forever. Oh, man, hey, look where it's going. Surely the coming of the Lord is soon. Amen? So you say, well, the world's getting worse and worse. Boy, that's too bad. Well, yes, it is too bad. But it also lets us know that the coming of the Lord is near. And I believe it. The old expression that Buddy attributed to Bob Jones, and I have no idea whether it's true or not. I've got Bob Jones saying, and I've never seen this one, but if the Lord doesn't come back soon, he's going to have to apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah. Now, obviously not true. I don't know if Bob Jones said it. If I've defamed him, I'm sorry. By the way, Bob Jones III will be preaching at the Pacific College graduation. Is that this Monday and Tuesday? Yeah. That's the 9th and 10th. If you want to hear Bob Jones III, personal friend of mine. Really? Yeah, I picked him up at the airport and went out to eat with him. Anyway, but not a personal friend of mine, but I know him and have talked to him and so forth. He doesn't know me, but I know him. He's going to be preaching Monday night and Tuesday night up at Brother Dunlop's church in Laverne. So, but when we see the world going this direction, in the last days, perilous times will come. You could look at that and say, hey, Lord's coming back. You say, what about my kids? They'll be all right. Amen. Amen. They'll be fine. If they're of age of accountability, they're saved, you'll all be fine in heaven. Let's not lament over leaving this world. Amen. Okay? Well, boy, you haven't done this. You know, we're in Bible college. You say, man, I hope the Lord didn't come back before I get a chance to preach. Then you preach for 26 years. Say, I wish the Lord come back 15 years ago. So the more sinful the world, the more soon the world beater comes, the Lord Jesus Christ. I read the back of the book and we won. Now, if you'll turn to Luke chapter 21, we will close with several verses in Luke chapter 21. Well, assistant superintendent I had, Skip Kenny, who, believe it or not, was a friend of Buddy Franklin's. And then later he was my superintendent in another district. But they told us one day, they said, look, we were teaching school, and he said, before the kids go home, he said, tell them something they learned today. He said, because they'll come home and they'll walk in, the parents will say, what'd you learn today? And the kid will say nothing. He said, so before they go home, tell them something they learned. Well, so that you don't go home today and say, What'd you learn today in church before you say nothing? Know this. God is going to judge the nations. God is a man of war. He's told us time and again, he's going to judge the nations. Those nations that forget God, it's not going to be good. Luke chapter 21, we will look at, let's look at verse 20. And when you shall see Jerusalem compassed with armies, then know that the desolation thereof is nigh. Then let them which are in the Judea flee to the mountains, and let them which are in the midst of it depart out, and let not them that are in the countries enter thereinto. For these be the days of vengeance, that all things which are written may be fulfilled. Those things that we've looked at tonight, they'll be fulfilled. But woe unto them that were child and to them that give suck in those days, for there shall be great distress in the land and wrath upon this people. And they shall fall by the edge of the sword and shall be led away captive into all nations, and Jerusalem shall be trodden down to the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. Now, we believe the times of the Gentiles are going to run right through the end of the tribulation, because the Gentiles will still be in control then before the Lord comes back and smites the nations for one time and then sets up his millennial kingdom. Then he'll let Satan out, he'll come back, and he'll do it again quickly. Verse 25. And there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars and upon the earth, distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, men's hearts failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Praise the Lord. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up. By the way, when you look up, you're looking toward heaven. You realize that? Hell is beneath. When these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. Now, we've been redeemed, but these bodies, if you will, the adoption of these bodies has not taken place yet. We're still walking around in these physical bodies. We can be burned at the stake, we can be shot, we can be all those things. Lift up your heads, look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. Now, we may go by the way of the grave before that happens, but it is going to happen. The Lord is a man of war. He's going to judge the nations. I'm sure America is going to be judged too. I hate to say it. I hate to say it. But look where we are. So, my conclusion was at verse 28. Look up. Lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. Father, we thank you. God, we love you. We read the back of the book and we won. Bad days are coming. They are upon us. Surely the rapture is close by. We're part of the church. We'll be raptured out of here. We won't be here for the seals, trumpets, and vials. Praise the Lord for that. We're thankful. We're going to be delivered from that hour to come, that hour of temptation to come. Thank you so much for it. Now, God, help us to be wise as serpents and harmless as doves. Help us to understand that the plan of the ages is unfolding. We see what God told us is going to happen. We see it happening. And God, let us not lose our patience. Let us not be distraught or fear. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. All of that, my Father's house of many mansions, if it were not so, I would have told you. We've got it made. Like Pauline saying, I am blessed. We are blessed because we have our position and our trust, including our future, in the Lord Jesus Christ, Lord of Lords, King of Kings. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.